Good evening.
Good evening, Tony. Oh, it's so, how's the Wi-Fi from Machu Picchu?
You know, not bad. They've really improved their technology up here. Wi-Fi is working great.
Awesome. That's just awesome. You know, one of my dearest friends is on the show tonight. First of all, I'm so thrilled and delighted to be part of the KGRA family. Mike has been a part of the family, as have you been for a while. So, you know, I'm the newcomer. I'm the new kid on the block, but it feels very comfy, very at home for me.
To have you as part of the family. Absolutely it fantastic. Is.
Kindred spirits, if ever there were.
Absolutely.
But I wanted to take just a moment tonight to remind everybody that's watching to hurry up and get your ticket for the live stream that begins to air next Friday night on the Dark Zone Live. It's going to be a three-day extravaganza with some of the best investigators in the country that are going to be at the farmhouse and my family. Three of us will be on the premises and three of us will be at a safe distance from Georgia. My mother, my sisters, Cindy and Christine, and really a great roundup of guests and people that are going to be involved with this broadcast. I'm really looking forward to it. Not so looking forward to the flight, but yeah. And I don't want to freeze to death while I'm up there. But other than that, I'm really looking forward to it. you know, it's, I mean, people don't, if they don't come from that area, they don't know how cold it can get. I can't tell you how many Halloweens I spent in my childhood trudging through snow with my sisters.
Same thing.
But, what I wanted to let everybody know this week on A World Awakening is that next week on A World Awakening, we will be coming live from the farmhouse. I'm really looking forward to that. Fingers crossed. Hopefully, I might have to just do it from my phone, which is kind of magical. It really is. I think that we'll have no problem with it. Tapping in because the Wi-Fi, it's Wi-Fi from hell at the farm. It is.
Yeah, I'm sure that may be a concern, but I do have an option that we may be able to get around that. We can talk about that later.
Oh, okay, good. Oh, God bless you. My techno wizard genius. Love it. So, okay. So anyway, everybody, if you haven't gotten your ticket yet, it's $20 for 3 days and three nights of interactive, immersive people. They're going to even open, I don't know if you know this, Tony, but they're going to open a chat room where viewers can hop in and talk to any member of my family,
right?
And communicate with the investigators as well. I don't do investigation. I don't feel like I need to prove that something exists that I already know exists. but it'll be enjoyable to be there with them and watch what they do. Because right. It's an entirely different skill set.
True. But what a great experience for the viewers. I mean, not only is it like watching TV, but you're watching live and you can interact. The fact that the chat room is multifunctional where you can send messages back and forth to anyone else in the chat room or anyone on the show if they're going to open it up where questions come in for any of you to answer. That's awesome. That's awesome.
It is. I'm really looking forward to it. Well, without further ado, Mike Ricksecker is, I think, one of the very best authors in the paranormal. He is a brilliant writer. He's a brilliant man. And he has a wealth of knowledge accumulated over decades of his life and has the ability to put them on paper, to put them into words in a way that few people do. He is rarefied in that respect. But that aside, he's one of the nicest human beings that I've ever had the privilege to meet.
We agree with that completely.
you know, and I know you met him a week or two ago at Vulcan City Parafest.
The Vulture City Paracon, yeah.
Vulture City, okay. Vulcan, you know me. It's got my head in.
Spock, vultures, it's all the
same. I know. I'm on the Starship Enterprise, you know, what can I tell you? You know, so you know now what I've known for a long time. Mike and I met probably 7 or 8 years ago and became fast friends. It's just been a wonderful, endearing ride with him. And he welcomed me into the paranormal community with open arms, just as kind and generous of spirit as any human being I have ever known. And because of Mike and others like him, yourself included, I am thankful every day that I found the courage to tell our family's story, because that's why I'm in this community now. So I would like to welcome the beautiful, the brilliant Mike Ricksecker to A World Awakening.
Thank you so much, Andrea, my amazing friend all these years. You're far too kind. And this is how much time flies. You realize it's been almost 10 years?
No way.
Yeah, it's almost 10 years, yeah.
Wow. Wow.
It was that the Emmett House, Waverly, Ohio.
Waverly, Ohio, yeah. I didn't even have my third book out yet. So that does go way back.
No, I think you just had the first one out.
No, I think I had the first two.
Did you have the first two? Okay.
Yeah, I think. Well, I'm not actually even sure, but yeah. I think I had the first two. The third one I was still working on. Mm-hmm. But you were sitting directly across from me.
Yep.
And once I got my table set up, I looked up and I saw your kind face and you smiled at me so warmly that I felt that I knew you instantly. And I came over and we chatted for, you know, quite some time. And then we continued our conversation throughout that weekend. I will always be sad that that beautiful building burned to the ground.
Oh, I know. That was such a shame. That was such a shame. And you're right. It was just, you know, an instant connection. It's like, you know, in a past life, I feel like, you know, you were my sister in a past life at some point. And I know you feel the same. So
I do.
Yeah, it was just amazing, immediate connection.
Yeah, it was. Well, tell us what you're up to now, because it's always something with you.
Yeah. It's been a busy year, you know, even with all the, you know, crazy, ridiculous, you know, COVID stuff going on. You know, I had the Egypt trip, back in June, did some different tours there. Of course, I saw you in both, Michigan and Massachusetts, which was absolutely fantastic. Saw, Tony there at Vulture City, but that was a 2-week trip in and of itself, because I was in Las Cruces, New Mexico just before that. But, you know, I had the second edition of my book, A Walk in the Shadows, come out at the very beginning of the year. I had my Shadow Dimension docuseries that I produced that you were a part of as well. And that came out back in, I want to say, April. It's running on Tubi TV right now for free. So anybody can just go to tubitv.com and watch it for free, or on the Tubi app. Or, you know, you can add that to your smart TV as well. And then my latest book, and I have to put it up here on the screen, that's Alaska's Mysterious Triangle, which just Ooh. Came out here October 12th. And that delves into all of that crazy, mysterious phenomenon that happens and occurs up in what's known as the Alaska Triangle, which is the television show that I'm part of on Travel Channel. So mm-hmm. a lot's going on.
Oh, that's marvelous. I know I told Tony earlier this year when things started picking back up again and people started doing events, and between working on, well, I've got about 7 things going at one time. I said, you know, Tony, I should rename my company Global Pandemic Productions, because it's just been amazing what I've gotten accomplished over the last 20 months or so. And yet, you know, it's also been a very difficult time. And I know how sweethearted and sensitive you are. And I know that this has been difficult for you as well. Because yeah. I think just about everybody knows somebody that we've lost, or we know somebody who has lost someone to this horrific virus. And I'm just hoping beyond hope that we get Sherry. Hi, Mike.
There's Sherry. Oh, all right.
There's Sherry. You know, yeah, it's, and thank you for everybody, you know, that are sending your well wishes to us and tuning in tonight. You know, it means the world to both of us and to Tony as well. I know it's been a difficult time. It's been an emotional time. It's been a dark time. And so we're the kind of people that try to find light wherever we can. And if we can't find it, we make it. We generate it. So how have you gotten through this period of time since the beginning of 2020 emotionally, like within yourself? And how have you processed all of this? What kind of journey has it been? And do you feel that you're in better headspace now than when it all began? Do you feel more hopeful, or is it still weighing on you? How's it been for you, sweetheart?
Oh, that's, you know, that's a tough question, Annie. Because I have lost several people here over the past year, whether to COVID or to other things. It was an uncle of mine last December. He was already suffering from a heart condition, contracted COVID, actually beat COVID, but it had decimated his system so much that he eventually succumbed to his heart condition. Our good friend Tim Schoen, just a month and a half ago, Coyote Chris Sutton, who I've done a lot of work with, great friend of mine, just, you know, stage four cancer. He just, you know, within a month of being diagnosed, he was suddenly gone. Just today, I found out a good family friend of mine had passed away. So it's been a tough year, whether it was COVID or not. You know, one of the things that I did not long after COVID hit was I came back home. I was elsewhere, as a different spot in life. I wasn't working out, and coming home to be near loved ones during this time has really been beneficial, because I think it's kind of one of those things that as you get older, you start to realize that, you know, the people that are in your life are not going to be around forever. So you want to stay close to those loved ones and spend as much time as you can. Of course, you still have to, you know, spread your wings and do the things that you need to do, but you also need to make time for those loved ones. So, you know, being 15 minutes from my parents, 20 from my sister, and then all the other family I have in the area has been absolutely fantastic. And, you know, we've been really supportive of each other. You know, we've lost a couple of people here, but we've been really supportive of each other. And I think that is extremely important.
Well, that warmth will carry you through a cold Ohio winter. Yes. I have been to Ohio in the winter. I know before we started the show, it was teasing. You went back to Ohio on purpose? To the frozen tundra?
Mm-hmm.
But you know, I totally get it, because family is everything. And I know that's, you know, it's home base for you. So it doesn't matter. I'm fortunate that all of my family lives down south now. Very fortunate.
You say a little warmer, yeah.
Yeah, because I've been completely, totally Floridized, I have to tell you. I really, really, really resent it when I have to put shoes on. Yes.
No, I totally understand it. Yeah, my sister hates Ohio. She's been trying to get people to move south for forever, it seems. And it's kind of humorous, because we spent those 10 years as kids in Massachusetts, and for a long time she was trying to get back to New England, you know, because she loves lighthouses and things like that, and so she wanted to get back to that area. And then kind of as she got older, she's like, no, I like the beach, give me the warm weather. So she's been trying to convince everybody to go south, but
yeah,
family's
and
kind of
plenty of lighthouses down here too.
I know
They don't, although, you know, I know you've been all over the country, and you would never know that the ocean off the east coast of Florida is the exact same ocean that's off the east coast of New England. It seems right. like a completely different body of water. Absolutely amazingly different. So, but I love going home to New England, and I'm really looking forward. I fly out of here on Tuesday, and to be able to go back to the farm, you know, my heart is filled with trepidation, because not that I have any fear of going to the farmhouse. I don't. It's not that. I'm afraid that this might be my last time at the farmhouse.
Yeah. Yeah. That was some really shocking news because they had just recently, you know, a couple of years ago purchased that. So to hear that, you know, it's
2.5 years
for sale again. Yeah. So that was really shocking. I hope it's not the last time that you're there, because I know how much that house means to you, but I guess we'll have to wait and see.
Yeah, I do. Well, I'm preparing myself emotionally and in every other way, spiritually, because it is such an important part of my life, and I was deprived of it for a number of years when the previous owner and I had a falling out around The Conjuring, and I just had to turn and walk away because I didn't want war. And it was very unfortunate. It was the only dark cloud that has ever hung over me or my story, our story. And that's over now. And I thought that it was over for good. I thought that Jen and Corey would have the house ad infinitum. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's strange. I feel like I find the house and I lose the house, and then I find the house and then I lose the house, then I find the house again and then I lose the house
It kind of drifts in and out of your life. Yeah.
Yeah. So. And yet it really is a permanent part of me. People ask me all the time if I dream about it, and I do, but it's not nightmares at all. It's not. It's something that is, there's a texture, a richness to visiting it in my night world that's really incredible. Have you had a chance to go there yet?
Well, you know I have. We covered that in the Shadow Dimension when I was there with Carl.
I was just trying to lead you in so that you could tell the story.
I was going to go there. I was going to go there.
Play along.
I was definitely going to go there, but you know, that time that I spent there, it was a single afternoon, and you know, it just wasn't enough. But in that short period of time, it was absolutely amazing. You know, because I'd heard all the stories. You know, I'd read your books. I talked to you countless number of times. We'd had you on the show. I don't know how many times we've had you on Edge of the Rabbit Hole now. Again, countless.
Yeah.
And so it was like, in a way, a type of homecoming for me, even though I'd never been there. Yeah. And just getting a chance to, you know, experience that, feel the energy, be able to see it firsthand, and then, you know, have my own experiences there while we were filming was truly amazing. And I hope that, you know, with the bit of research that we did and the presentation that we gave that house in the Shadow Dimension docuseries, that we were able to shed a little bit more light on what happens there. And, you know, I was hoping that we'd be able to go back and film a little bit more and follow up on the things that, you know, we believe that we discovered. Of course, I'm not sure if we're going to be able to do that now. But even if we don't, you know, I hope it still causes people to wonder and question and, you know, do their own research, if they will.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would hope so. I would love it if everybody would have an opportunity, whoever wanted to, would have an opportunity, even just to walk through it. You know, even just to, like you said, feel the energy of the place, because it is really quite unusual. But you've been to a number of, I guess, what you would call historically haunted places, and your experiences you know, I want you to talk about more about your series. And yeah, you know, I was trying to give you a little bit of a lead in there for that.
Once you start talking about the house, I was going to go there. But yeah, you know, because COVID kind of, you know, hindered our original plans for the Shadow Dimension docuseries. And so we were still able to get to two places, which was great. So the one was the farmhouse. And we pretty much the first four episodes are centralized on the farmhouse. The other two episodes cover Mineral Springs Hotel out in Alton, Illinois, which is again, a location that has fantastic energy. It's right there on the Mississippi River. You have the limestone bluffs that are right there. The Piesaw Caves are right up the river. Cahokia Mounds are just down the river a little bit. So you have this fantastic area with all of this energy. And kind of very similar to the farmhouse, it has a hole in the middle of the sub-basement this was the mineral spring where they were bringing that water up to be able to bottle and to be able to feed into the pools there at the hotel. And so still to this day, that hole is open. They've thrown some trash in there so people don't fall in. But, again, here's this opening into that ground that, you know, we're down there with dowsing rods and just immediately the rods point right at the hole. That's where the energy is coming from. And so it just, and it feeds the rest of the building. And it's a very, very interesting location. Shadow Dimension, sure, we're, you know, looking for, that shadow-based activity. But really it has more to do with, even though, yeah, we're kind of focusing on shadows, it has more to do with the interdimensional connections between all of this activity, whether it's shadows or whether it's apparitions or whether it's this other activity going on inside the location. These locations are also, beacons for, the extraterrestrials, the ETs. And so you have all of that activity there that this energy is feeding.
Let me ask you a question, because this is a question that I get asked quite frequently. And I don't know if I'm even answering it correctly. It's correct for me because of my interpretation of the word. But I am frequently asked about what I've said so often, that the farmhouse is a portal cleverly disguised as a farmhouse. That it is actually some kind of energetic opening to elsewhere. What do you think is the definition for you of a portal? And do you think that the farmhouse and other places that you have visited qualify according to that definition?
Yeah, so I do agree with your assessment of the farmhouse. I mean, I've only been there one time. You lived there for many years. But in just my one day there, I absolutely agree with you. And I actually, shameless plug, but I actually do define portal in Alaska's Mysterious Triangle to try to clear up, because a lot of times people will try to, and I understand why, people will interchange the word portal and vortex and, these different types of energy currents. And trying to educate a little bit. So with a portal, I mean, basically this is a gateway into some other realm, some other plane of existence. Now, what's powering that is typically, like when I'm talking about the Alaska Triangle or other triangle areas around the world, it's basically that magnetic energy that's welling up from the Earth's magnetic core, and it will spawn off different things like portals. It could be gateways, it could be stargates, it could be all kinds of different things. At the farmhouse there, you had time slips, okay? So that would be, the portal kind of, opening just for a moment so you get a glimpse, and you're taking a glimpse through that doorway into some other plane of existence. And those things are absolutely fascinating. I think with the farmhouse, I mean, you have very historic land there anyway, but something that I noticed about that, and I really, it's really started to click when I just getting the tour from Corey, and then observing the things that happened to us and taking your tales into account, that well room is absolutely fascinating to me.
Yeah.
Because you have, you know, an open well in the middle of the floor. There's still water in it. The walls are made of limestone and they're capped with granite blocks. It's a perfect little power plant there to help energize that house. And you had so many things happen. Just if you look straight up from the well room up to, you know, the parlor above you, and then your bedroom that you had there, so many things have happened in that area straight up from there. And like I said, there's already something going on with the land anyway. So this is supercharging whatever was already going on there for all that activity to start happening in the house. So yes, portal cleverly disguised as a farmhouse. Absolutely.
Is this what you want to do for the rest of your life? What you do, all that you do. It's not a hobby, Mike. It's not. It shouldn't even qualify as a hobby. It's, you are one of the strongest voices with the farthest reach in this community.
Thank you. This is really what I've always wanted to do. I've been writing since I was 7 years old. So when I was a younger man, did I envision all the different things that I'm doing now? No, I wanted to be a writer. And I threw this out there as a meme a few years ago, and I'm not sure how the community took it, but the meme was, I just wanted to be a writer. The world wanted more from me. And so that's been part of my journey. You know, started off with, I was writing little mystery stories and little ghost stories, even did some historic fiction as a 7 year old, if you could imagine historic fiction as a 7 year old. And it just continued to grow. And as I had my own life experiences and I saw different things, and, you know, sometimes the universe just kind of pulls you aside from a certain path and sends you down another one. You know, I was, you know, I had my mystery novel that was already out, and yeah, I had done some small things with the paranormal community, you know, back in the day, like when I was in high school, I had my first little paranormal investigation, didn't realize it. And, you know, but I was still always curious and I was still always poking and prodding, and finally the universe just came along. And even though I had started down the path of mystery writing, it just took me and put me into the paranormal field. I had the editor for the one publishing company that I had written some books for a long time ago just said, hey, you know, I know that you're writing fiction. I've seen some of your paranormal short stories. We're trying to expand our line of paranormal books. You're living in Maryland. Would you be willing to write a book on true ghost stories in Maryland?
And I loved that. Of course, I was like, my mother loved that book. That's like the biggest compliment that you can get. I called you. I know. I told you.
You did. You did.
Yep. Like, oh, you got mom's seal of approval on this, babe. Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, that's fantastic. And I always appreciate those words from your mother, that that she's really liked my work. So that means a ton to me. But yeah, that moment was, you know, the universe kind of course corrected me. It was like, okay, you've started down a path. We just need to, you know, push you over here and get you down the paranormal, supernatural. It's grown into so many more things too, because it's not just about the things that go bump in the night. You know, we're talking about much, you know, deeper knowledge. You know, we're talking lost civilizations, lost history, lost knowledge. We're talking about the inner workings of the universe. We're talking about contact with ETs. You know, all these different things throughout the universe are connected. And so, yeah, while it started off as the ghost stories, now I've branched off into this learning platform called the Connected Universe Portal. So it's a lot bigger, and it keeps growing. Mm-hmm.
So I guess the answer to my question is you'll do this for as long as you're around.
Yeah, okay. That was the long-winded version of saying yes.
No, it was perfect. But
I got to give you something. I just can't sit here and say, yes, Annie, of course.
Oh, yeah. I mean, haven't both of us had those interviews over the course of the years?
Yes. Yeah.
No, my favorite ones, you'll get a hoot out of this. Are the ones that, you know, told people that call me and ask me or write to me on my website and say, I know everything about your story. I'm so fascinated about it. I'd love to have you on my podcast to do an interview. And then I agree, thinking, you know, these folks have really done their homework and, oh, this is great and this will be interesting and this will be fun. And then I get on the show and they're like, we saw The Conjuring. Oh, God. Oh, oh dear geez. God. Oh, dear God. Do you even know the name of my trilogy of books? No, but right. We know you wrote one. Okay, so I'm going to obviously have to run this interview. It's just, yeah, makes me kind of nuts.
Yeah, no, I've had those, you know, if somebody will, contact me for an interview about shadow people and, you know, they'll say that they purchased the book. Oh yeah, you know, love your book, A Walk in the Shadows. And they get on to the interview. And one of the first questions is, well, have you had an experience with a shadow person? It's like, you didn't read the book, did you?
Didn't read the book. Nope.
Or I know. Watch any of the, like, you know, 500 videos I have out there on YouTube. There,
yeah. Yeah, or mine, you know. Oh, you have a YouTube channel? Yeah, yeah. I sure do. It's got 10 years of videos on it. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, I know. But, you know, I guess that just comes with the territory, Mike. It's just why I'm, you know, so comfortable having you on the show, knowing that we can have an intelligent, erudite conversation about this, and we both know each other's stuff. You know, we know each other personally very well, but we also know each other's stuff, and that matters. It really does. It really matters. It really because does. Then you can get into the depth of it. One of the things that I don't think that we've ever talked about, as I bajillion times. It's really one of the very best shows out there. It really is. So professionally done. So I just can't say enough about you. I can't say enough nice stuff about you. I just can't. But what I really wanted to talk to you about, and I don't think that we ever have, is what your, how you perceive your spiritual growth and evolution as a person, as a man, throughout the course of all of these years of writing about the history and mystery of the world. Because you don't just focus your attention on this particular place or that particular place. What you do is intermingle everything into one thing. And
right.
That is a gift to do that, because what it does is it expands the mind of your reader in ways that are quite unexpected. That was one of the compliments that my mother gave you, was that you managed to touch on so much in that book about Maryland that had nothing to do with Maryland. It had to do with not only the whole world, but the universe.
Exactly. Because, you know, I believe all these things are connected. So even in my recent book, Alaska's Mysterious Triangle, you know, I tell some stories there from Oklahoma, or when I was a kid in Massachusetts, or some things that happened to me as a teenager in Ohio, because they're all, you know, relevant. And sure, there are plenty of stories in there of, you know, when I was a young airman in the Air Force and stationed there in Alaska, but all these different things are connected. And, yes. You know, by the end of the book, I am drawing these connections from Alaska to Antarctica to, you know, the lost city of Atlantis. You know, everything is related and it's connected. As far as my spiritual journey, you know, I've always felt a connection to the spiritual side of our universe. And, you know, as a child, I grew up Catholic. So it was through that lens, like you, yes. Yeah. it was through that lens that I viewed the spiritual world. And as I grew and started to learn more as I went out on my own, you know, that changed over the years, and I had a number of, you know, different experiences, whether I tried a different Christian church, or, you know, I dove into some esoteric text. You know, as that knowledge grows, so does your wisdom within the world, as you have those experiences and you learn from those. And you know, right now I would not really even define myself as anything specific. I think there's a big difference between religion and spirituality. Yes. So
huge. Chasm-like. Yes.
I would almost say this is going to sound kind of funny. I would almost call myself universal. However, that is what the word Catholic actually means.
I know. So. Yeah. No, that kind of blows that theory sky.
Right. It does. Yeah. But it is. I mean, it's, you know, with what I believe these days, with everything within the universe being connected, me to you, us to, you know, the moon, to Mars, to other solar systems out there, to other, you know, to other spiritual beings that are out there in different worlds. It really is a universal language that we seek to speak.
It is. And, you know, that's the beauty of what we do is neither you nor I compartmentalize ourselves. And when I first developed the idea of going to a broader, larger audience with a World Awakening, going from just a little blog talk radio show, which was really very successful for 2.5 yeah. years. And then I took a hiatus and I really needed to think about everything that was happening, where it was going, how the world was changing, how my own spirituality was burgeoning in different ways. And then decided to relaunch it with Tony Rathman as my paranormal production partner. He's so fabulous. He's so fabulous. I know.
And I'm so happy you're doing this again too.
Yeah, I really am too. I felt like the time, I felt a calling to do it. You know, I did. I felt a calling to do it. Like there was a void that needed to be filled with my little show. And now to have it go into syndication out of nowhere, like it was just dropped in my lap, like, you want to do this? Oh, sure. Okay. Yeah. Okay. I mean, it was that fast. It was just like done. It was that fast. I feel gifted by the universe. I feel like it's that little cosmic kiss that says, yes, you're going in the right direction. Kind of like when your publisher said, well, we'd like to expand a little bit. You know, this is, you know, oh, hi, Erin. Oh, I love her. I feel like the universe, if we don't follow our destiny and listen from within ourselves to where we're supposed to go, the universe will give us a nudge. And, you know, and we can nudge back yeah. against it and say, no, I'm not comfortable taking this path. I'm going to stay on this path right now. But then it'll come along and give you a little shove. I mean, a lot of people don't know this, but I had always been a writer. I had always been a writer. I wrote my first book when I was 5 years old and did all my own illustrations courtesy of a box of Crayola crayons. It was, you know, I'm like, oh, I can do this. This all makes sense. It's perfect. My mother still has it. She keeps everything.
That was my mom too. She kept everything and she gave a lot of it back to me, but I know she still has a few things hiding in her house there.
Yep. But I was 48 years old when I decided that it was time to tell our story about living at the farmhouse. And I'll never forget the day that my mom walked up to me. I had left Rhode Island. I knew I needed to be with my family. I needed to go south again. And I didn't want to live in Georgia again. I didn't want to live in the South again at the time because Rhode Island feels, I'm so grounded there. It feels my little tiny state is home. That's home. Yeah. The farm is home. I only lived 10 miles away from it. I could go whenever I wanted. And I left all of it so that I could tell the story of it and tell it authentically, tell it organically, tell it through not only my voice, but me as a child and my family all involved in the telling of it. You know, I've always called it a collective memoir. It's all of us. but I was 48 years old when that bell went off in my head, and it just said, okay, the world's ready now for this. It is. And my mother approached me when I guess I had been in Georgia for a few months, and I was working diligently on it. I had left my job. I left my theater company. I left everything behind, everything, to start fresh, to write the trilogy, which was only one book. It somehow turned into three. I don't know how that happened. And she came up to me one day and she said, I'm really proud of you for doing this. She said, we lived this, and this is not the kind of story that one should rightfully take to the grave. If we lived it, we should have the courage to share it. And she was absolutely right about that. And Mike, I'll tell you what, I didn't know if there was anybody out there that would want to read the story of what happened to this, you know, average middle class family from Little Rhodey in an old colonial farmhouse, like if it would make any difference in the world at all. And talk about a world awakening to me, a whole new world has what a gift, the friendships that have made, and the people, the wonderful people that I've met. And I know you feel the same way. Think of all the people that we've met doing these different events, going around the country. Aren't they just incredibly wonderful?
Oh, they really are. There's so many lifelong friendships that I've made along the way that I would not have had if I hadn't started following this path. You know, if I was just, you know, working a 9-to-5 job, which I still do, by the way, but if that was it for me, there's so many people I would not have met, so many friendships that I just am so thankful to have, you know, including you, of course. But when we do this, writing, and we're putting ourselves out there and telling our stories, there's so many different things that we're doing here. You know, for one, you know, all those people that are reading the story that maybe they had some sort of experience that was very similar. They realize they're not alone in this. There are other people right. that are having these experiences, that have seen these things, that have felt these things. So they realize, okay, I'm not crazy. There are other people that are witnessing this same sort of thing. You know, we're also giving a voice to those people who have passed long before us. Those people, the others that lived there at the farmhouse, and you're recounting their story, so they're not forgotten to time. You know, the people that I've covered in my work, and then we're providing information that hopefully will not be forgotten over time. I think part of what we're doing is, you know, sure, this is great knowledge for us as we're living now, but we need to pass that on to the next generation so that it's not forgotten, because too many times humanity keeps making the same mistakes over and over and over again, and we can help alleviate some of that if we're able to pass information on to the next generation. Hopefully, they'll pick up the mantle and do something better.
Knowledge is power.
Absolutely.
And one of the things... Wendy Williams. Mike has a new show on KGRA. You've been on KGRA for a while, haven't you?
Yeah, a little over a year. I think we started June or July last year, something like that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I have two. There's Edge of the Rabbit Hole and there's Connecting the Universe.
Right.
So Edge of the Rabbit Hole will be 1 a.m. Eastern tonight, and then Connecting the Universe is midnight tomorrow night.
Awesome. I knew that. Aaron wants to know, Mr. Ricksecker. Just call him Mike, Aaron. Oh, my God.
Yeah, just call me Mike.
You're going to meet him in your travels. Actually, I want to be dragging her along with me on things. Of all the subjects you've studied, which one owns your heart the most?
You know, that is such a tough question, because I've had so many fascinating experiences. There's so many places that I've researched and studied, and so there are a few. I loved covering the farmhouse. That was amazing, because I was able to integrate my own story with experiences that you've had there. And it was like a homecoming for me too, because I spent those 10 years, growing up in Massachusetts, right down the road. My uncle, before he passed away, had lived in Rhode Island for decades. So it was really a homecoming for me to cover that. Mineral Springs Hotel is another one that's really close to my heart. I've done so much, work out of there. It's tough. Because people know me as kind of like the shadow person guy, because that's really kind of where I got my start, having the experiences that I had when I was very young. A lot of the research I'm starting to do now, when it comes to lost civilizations, ancient Egypt, you talk about the universe calling out to you. Egypt was not on the radar, a year and a half ago. And all of a sudden, there I was this past June, because of the Alaska Triangle show, I ended up in Egypt, and now we're doing a tour here in another year out there. So there's so much, Annie, to really try to pin it down to one specific thing. Cause again, it's all connected anyway.
It is. It's all connected anyway. Well, the first book report that I ever wrote, I was, I think it was 9 or 10 years old, and I put so much time into it. I read, our teacher unleashed us in the library and said, go pick any book you want to read and read that book and write me a report about it. And I immediately gravitated to a book about what felt like this magical place to me called Stonehenge. I had no familiarity with it. It, hadn't come up in my life yet. I was still quite young. We were still living in Cumberland, hadn't moved to the farm yet. But it was like a laser beam. That was the book. I went right to that book as though I was literally being guided over to it. Here, it's right here on this shelf. It's right here. Pull this book out. And I open it to a picture of Stonehenge. And the fascination was instantaneous. And I'm going, for the first time in my life, on a paranormal tour of England next summer.
Yeah, that's fantastic. To be able to to be able to visit a location like that you've always wanted to get to. And that's through Mysterious Adventures Tour, which we're doing the Ireland trip in July 1st through the 9th. And Ireland is one of those locations I've long talked about wanting to get to. And we still have 3 spots open for that, by the way. being able to, kind of similar for me, you talk about Stonehenge, and Stonehenge is a bucket list item of mine too. I mean, really anything that is, very old, historic, ancient, there's so much lost knowledge in those types of locations that I think we really need to pay attention to. The whole Egypt thing, I remember early 90s when, I forget the exact title of it, but it was that documentary where Charlton Heston was the presenter, but it was basically with Robert Schock and John Anthony West, where they were talking about redating the Sphinx that became really controversial. And right about that same time, the movie Stargate came out, and it was like, wait a minute, these two things are talking about very similar topics. So they seem to be, and I've been fascinated about it ever since. And there I was this past June. And now I've made a fantastic friendship with Mohammed Ibrahim, who runs Guide of Egypt tours out there. And, now we're working together. So it's like, wow, this is just absolutely fascinating. How
don't you have to pinch like yourself? Yeah,
absolutely.
I have to pinch myself sometimes. I do. With the remarkable people that I've met and the incredible adventures that I've been on. If you had asked me 10 years ago, if this would be what my life looked like, I just turned 63. If you had asked me at 50, what's your life going to look like? You know, and not in my wildest dreams, not in my wildest imagination could I have conjured up what my life is now compared to what it was then. You know, I was
pun intended, conjured up.
Yeah. You know, it's, and that's the magic and the marvel, mm-hmm. I think, of following your inner voice. One of the women who is in our chat tonight, Erin, who just asked a profoundly important question, just made a deliberate detour in her life just a year or two ago, and it completely, utterly altered her life. And she and I met while I was out walking Peanut Buttercup, the princess, at the Strange Escapes event, Amy and Adam's event down in St. Augustine about maybe 6 weeks ago. And I looked at her and I felt so immediately drawn to her. And I had seen her. She was kind of hanging back and laying low and observing everything at this event and, you know, not buoyantly in your face like so many people are. They're so excited to see you and they have a thousand questions. And she was just hanging back. And I sat down next to her while Peanut was finding a place to pee. And we immediately struck up a conversation. And then my father came out. And within a few minutes, she was assimilated into my life. Like assimilated into my life. Like, I can't even explain it. There is no explaining it other than destiny. And she said to my dad the other day, "You might not have even liked me a couple of years ago. I was so straight-laced and, kind of a legal eagle and doing some really remarkable work as a professional in a whole different world." And she was not happy. And she was smart enough to listen to her inner voice that said, "You know what? Maybe it's time to make a change." I hope I'm not divulging too much, but I did have her on my show a few weeks ago and she was very forthcoming. So I don't think I'm sharing too much personally. She'll let me know if I am.
Right, but, right.
Too late. It's on the radio and it's out there forever afterwards.
It's out there now.
Too bad. But one of the most...
and there she is. You can tell whatever you like.
Tell
there
whatever
you go.
I like. Okay. Thank you, darling. Because it's a fascinating story. And I think that the life lesson from Erin's story is just to listen to your inner voice and let it guide you, because your inner voice is the voice of the ages. It's your ancient history. It's your ancestors. It's your path. It's your willingness to expand your consciousness in this realm and not, you know, for love or money, keep yourself locked into something that doesn't bring you joy. And I have to say that being a part of really a worldwide paranormal community that I did not know existed when I started writing my books has been truly illuminating for me in every conceivable way and has changed my life in literally every conceivable way, much like moving into the farmhouse as a 12-year-old.
Right.
Now, speaking of which, you, how can I put this?
Uh-oh.
I know a lot of men, particularly men, who had experiences with what I refer to as the galactic family. Extraterrestrials. I don't like calling them aliens. That just sounds so...
No, not aliens.
You know, it's just the wrong word. They're no more alien to this planet than we are, for one thing.
Sure.
I refer to them as our galactic family because that's how I perceive them. And all the men that I know, and it's a lot, who went into the Air Force, went into the military, went into the Air Force, felt compelled to do so because they had a close encounter as a child. Does that hold true for you?
My Air Force story is a little different. Now, I had always I always had an interest in space. I feel so bad for my sister, because I've just recently found out here that the recruiter that I had had, she had actually inquired with him, because she actually went to space camp, and so she had an interest in pursuing that as a career, and he kept telling her, go to the Navy. She's like, no, I know the Air Force covers this. And so she ended up stopping her pursuit of that. And I felt so bad, because it was like, no, that was certainly a legitimate thing. Because when I was stationed in Alaska, basically the sheets came down that, you know, if you want to, you know, throw your name into the hat, into the astronaut program, here you go. I was immediately disqualified because of my eyesight. But it was certainly a thing. So that's always been there. I've always had a draw to space and the cosmos. And, you know, I've owned a telescope ever since I can remember.
Yeah, me too.
You know, opening up those.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I have one in the living room right now. The one that I had when I was a kid, it broke at some point. But I've always had one. I've always been a sci-fi geek. I was just, Nicole and I were just watching Dune earlier today, the new one.
Is it good?
It's pretty good. I think it's a good adaptation. People have to keep in mind, you know, the book does a lot of explaining of the world and that universe, but mm-hmm. I think they did a good job, and the visuals are really great. I think they did a good job of, you know, breaking up, okay, explaining this, and here's some action, explaining mm-hmm. this, here's some action. They did a good job, so, but it's definitely a two-parter, so. Mm-hmm. So all those topics have always fascinated me. My foray into the Air Force is actually different, though. It didn't necessarily have to do with pursuing that, although it was there as an option. I knew I could achieve that in the Air Force. I talk about it very briefly because. And now that I have several copies of these, sending a copy to my best friend from high school, Ron, and telling him, this is all your fault. Because my friend Ron, he graduated a year ahead of me. Most of my friends that I had in high school graduated a year ahead of me.
Yeah, that's true of me too. Yep.
Yeah, okay. And he had decided, because he was kind of unsure for a while what he was going to do. We played music together. You know, we had our own little band and that sort of thing going on. We also played baseball together. So we were pretty tight. And he decided, it was around the time that I had started my senior year, and he's at that point where, you know, everybody had gone off that he graduated with, had basically gone off to college. He's like, what am I going to do? And so he ended up enlisting in the Air Force. And he basically convinced me, hey, you should look into this too. You can get the college paid for, you know, these different interests that you have, you could pursue those. So mm-hmm. space was certainly a part of that. They had the computer program, which is what I ended up going into. So he kind of sold me on going into the Air Force. So it's Ron Stevens, it's your fault.
Yeah.
And he knows it too, which is funny. It's a little bit different.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I've always found it strange that so many of the men that I know that, and really from all over that don't know each other at all, had experiences in their youth, and it just, they felt drawn to wanting to be in a plane and get up there. See what they could see from, you know, 30, 40,000 feet.
Yeah. I mean, for me, I want to get in the rocket and go up. You know, that the whole idea of, you know, now I just need the money to do it, apparently, because they're charging how many millions of dollars per ticket. But, you know, or maybe I just become as big of a name as William Shatner and have them send me up there. No. I want to go up. Yeah.
So do I. You know, I have a funny story about that too, because My sister Christine, I was, I think last Christmas, I was up in Georgia with Mom and Christine, and she said, I don't know, I don't even know why the subject came up, but she said something about, you know, NASA doesn't do, you know, nearly what it used to do, and they're, you know, jobbing out all of this to private this and private that, and, you know, what's going on with NASA? And I said, oh, honey, there's plenty going on with NASA. Mm-hmm. NASA went underground a while ago. You know, this is, there's plenty going on with NASA. You just don't know about it. And they started at that point, they were talking about, you know, sending civilians up into space. And she said, oh, I would never do that. I don't care how rich I am. I would never do that. And I said, oh, my God, I would go in a heartbeat. And heck, she just looked at me and she said, you just want to go see your little friends. And I copped immediate attitude with her. And I said, I don't have to go see them. They come see me. And she's like, oh, well, whatever. You know, I think, and I said, and they're not that little.
Right.
Yeah. So
I think a big draw for me is that, you know, I don't want to just read about it in a book or, mm-hmm. you know, see a documentary on TV. I want to see and touch and feel with my own body. I mean, that was like an amazing part of, you know, for me going to Egypt earlier this year, is that, sure, I'd seen a bunch of photographs. I had, you know, seen all kinds of things on TV and all that, and it looked amazing. But when you actually stand in the presence of those monuments and you're looking at it and you realize these things are massive, it's like, sure, it looks big in the photographs, but when you are actually surrounded by it and you're feeling that energy and you're just overwhelmed by the sheer size, it's just majestic. And that's what I want. You know, going out into space, I don't just want to see a photograph or, you know, the Hubble telescope images or whatever. I want to go out there and see it myself and experience it.
Yeah, so do I. And I think about being off planet, and I know that I have been, because the experiences that I've had, I could not have conjured in my own imagination. I couldn't have. I've had experiences. It's interesting. One of my dear friends is Chase Klotsky. And I was, I don't know if you know Chase. You'll eventually run into her, but she's one of those crossovers, you know, where she studies UFOs, but she also studies the paranormal. She's military, former military forensic scientist. She's been on gobs of shows, from Ancient Aliens to you name it, she's been on it. And we were standing in a dinner line one time at the Star Wars Symposium, Paula Harris's fantastic event that she runs every year in Laughlin, Nevada. And somebody asked her if she'd ever been off planet. And she said, yes. You know, she answered a little reluctantly, I'm sure, because she might not have known who was asking her. And there's always somebody from the government at all of these events that we do. There's always, I can pick them out from like 100 yards away. But she seemed reluctant to answer it at first. And I just looked at her and I kind of nodded. And she said, yes. And she said, I've been to a place, a planet, that is every conceivable shade of blue that you can imagine, and then 100 shades of blue that you've never seen before. And then she said, and it has. And I looked at her and I said, 2 moons. She's like, yes. I'm like, I knew it. I knew it.
You've been there too.
I knew that we were from the same place. And I'm certain it's in the Pleiades. I'm certain of it. And I don't know how I know that, but I'm certain of it. And I think, you know, as much as I say the farmhouse on Earth is home to me, well, that's really home. And then we started, you know, we just completely blew off the guy that asked the question. And we're standing there grabbing our food and we're talking about how the two moons, even though they're in completely different rotations, intersect so that it looks like the large moon that's way further out, the smaller moon is much closer in. But when they cross, and it, you've got a moon inside a moon, and it's just this incredible, incredible thing. And, you know, we just, oh my God, we sat at the same table. We talked all night. It was just so great. I'm like, I knew it. I knew the first time I looked into your blue eyes that were identical to my blue eyes, that we were from the same place. And the interesting thing is that she and I grew up in Rhode Island and lived there at the same time. And never met each other until 40 years after we left Rhode Island.
Fascinating. Yeah, it's, you know, we make that comment sometimes, it's a small world, but there's a reason for that. Because we are so connected to other people. But yeah, you know, it's funny. When I was a kid and when I was in third grade, I used to joke around all the time that I was originally from Pluto. And it just seemed like a joke at the time. But, you know, years later when they downgraded Pluto from a planet to a dwarf planet, I was so overly offended that it was just, you know, it's kind of very uncharacteristic of me. But I was. And so, you know, it's like, okay, what is this connection? But, you know, talking with other people over the years, there are others that I've talked to that have said the same thing when they were a kid, that they were originally from Pluto. And it's like, there's something to that. You know, that is not just coincidence. There's certainly something to it.
Yeah, there is. And, you know, we might not have any explanation for that in our lifetimes. We might not. It might just be part of what opens that compartment in our imagination and our curiosity and our fascination, that driving force that keeps us plowing forward into trying to learn more and ever more about not only ourselves in connection with planet Earth, but how we fit into the grand scheme of things. Where do we come from? Why are we here? Where are we going?
Now, absolutely. And we might not figure it out in our lifetimes, but this is what I was saying before about passing this information on, passing on to the next generation so that they feel inspired to keep it going. And maybe they can figure it out. Or, you know, if not our children, our grandchildren, you know, somebody down the line, you know, keep it going. Yeah. And hopefully somebody will figure it out one of these days. And
yeah,
you know, we will have played our part in all of that.
I really do think that one of the most unique attributes and one of the most important attributes to being a human being is our curiosity.
Yes.
I really do believe that that's what keeps us growing, expanding, learning, looking, seeking. One of the most important elements of our humanness is our ability to see beyond ourselves and to seek out more about ourselves in conjunction with and connection to the larger space that we inhabit. We are not just like little specks of sand on a beach. Everything is integrated.
Right. And it's such a fascinating time to, you know, to have that curiosity, because, you know, there are a lot of doors that are actually opening to us these days. If we were talking about these sorts of things 50, 60, 70, 100 years ago, we'd have the door slammed in our faces.
Yes.
They might lock us up and throw us in a loony bin. You know, a lot of things could potentially happen to us. You know, there's very few, you know, there's a few people that you can look back at, you know, their texts and the things that they wrote. You know, you could look at like Madame Blavatsky or, you know, Manly P. Hall, people like that, but it's just a handful that were able to kind of, quote unquote, get away with it and put the information out there. But so many others that were talking about the same subjects were hushed. They were locked up. They were put away. They were put down, whatever it was. But in today's day and age, we're free to talk about so many of these different topics. So, yeah, to have that curiosity now is gold. And so, yeah, just take hold of it and let's push forward with it.
Well, I think that we are at a point of reckoning, a point of awakening. Some call it the Great Awakening, but I think that humanity has always been in the process of awakening. I just think that there's something rapidly happening now as we leave what has been referred to as the Piscean Age,
right,
and come into the Age of Aquarius.
Yep.
I really think that we're
I lose connection. We lose connection?
No, the connection is still going. I think she froze.
She froze.
Yeah, we'll give her just a minute. I'm sure she'll either pop back on or go off and come back on. But
that's all right. I mean, I could continue on the thought because I think I know
where she was going, Mike.
With that. Yeah, bringing ourselves from one age, from Pisces into Aquarius, you know, we're on that threshold of, you know, dawning on the Age of Aquarius, which isn't a specific year. It's more like a time frame, and we're within that period of time, and there she is, she's back. And so, you know, it's almost kind of like, you know, we're leveling up, you know, we're transcending into a new consciousness, you know, from the old into the new.
Yeah.
So.
Don't you think it's interesting? Yes, that's exactly where I was going with it. And don't you think as soon as we brought up that subject, or I brought up that subject,
boom,
all the technology was like, okay, I'm going to fuck with you now. Okay, watch this.
Pretty much.
You know, I mean, it was like just an energy shot. You know, that happened with Tenny last week, too. It didn't last quite as long. It came, you know, it came right back. But, yeah, I mean, I've got, you know, 5 bars. You know, I'm hardwired into, you know, I know you are. I know Tony is. Yeah. I know the station is. And sometimes it's just the universe saying, okay, you want to talk about this now? You want to talk about, you want to go there? Really? You want to go there? Yeah, we do. We actually do. But
absolutely.
Sometimes I think it's the universe just expelling a cosmic kiss or a universal sigh that just generates so much energy that it totally screws up our works, you know, our electronics. But it is a time of a great expansion of human thought, and I believe that there is a global awakening that is occurring, that a wave of consciousness expansion is exploding around the entire earth, which is why I feel like we're right on the precipice of something huge coming. And I have felt that, you know, what I've always referred to as the paradigm shift. Yeah. Now this is it. We're living in it. This is it. And yes, I completely agree. You know, the Piscean Age didn't end on a certain day, and the Age of Aquarius started on a certain day. There's a gradual intermingling and an evolution of thought and growth, expansion that is suddenly taking place, where we're shifting from being entirely ego-based, internalized beings to having a higher vision of ourselves as part of the great and wondrous whole. And there's backlash to it. There's backlash to it. Because what do human beings hate more than anything? The one constant in the universe is change.
Right.
And we are
that's a challenge, because we are in the middle of this shift, and you have those old stalwarts that just, they don't want the world to change, but it has to. You know, the universe has to change and evolve. And if you look at, you know, human history, those changes happen. So we're in the generation now where that shift is occurring, which is why you're seeing all this turmoil all over the world, and mm-hmm. all these different crazy things happen. And, you know, every, when you look back and you look at these different paradigm shifts, like you're saying, you see that conflict that happens, because you have those people that don't want to change. They like the way the world works, but in order to continue to expand and evolve, not just as a species, but as a consciousness, as spiritual entity that we are. We have to change. We have to morph and turn into something else. And so it's kind of the growing pains of it. And that's where we're at right now. We're in the throes of those growing pains.
Yes, we are. And the struggle, power struggles, you know, to maintain a consistency of how it always was versus what it's becoming, that clash and that conflict has really dropped a very dark scrim behind the beacon of light and hope for the future. And it's not just COVID, it's not just civil unrest, it's not just political upheaval, it's everything,
right?
All of it intertwines, all of it is intermingled, all of it is relevant to all the rest of it, because in the metaphor that I use in my latest book, it's like we're that little baby chick that's trying to peck our way out of our shell. You know, in the whole world, when you're a baby chick and you're in the shell and you're just getting to the point where, you know, you're starting to feel like you need to break out of that thing, you know, that's your whole universe right there. That is your whole universe. You don't know anything else about life because you're in that shell. And our shell is cracking. And there are many, many of us that are beginning to peck our way out. And so when people say to me, well, you know, why doesn't your galactic family get down here and help us? Because, like, you know, we're in a boatload of trouble down here. And I've asked them that myself many times when I get frustrated or angry or feel like, you know, we're just not moving forward fast enough, that sometimes we're moving backward. And, you know, and the answer that I always get, always, always, is, you know, we're already here. We're already here. And
well,
they are.
And it's, I think it's part of that, you know, to use another animal analogy, like the, in kind of the same type of concept, you know, like the moth or the butterfly, you know, we need the struggle to get out and become that beautiful creature. And if somebody comes along and helps us, well, right, exactly. You know, if you try to help a moth or a butterfly out of their cocoon, they're not going to...
They won't survive.
Build up that strength and they will not survive.
That's right. And the same with the chicken. The same with the little baby chick. If you break that egg for them, they will not have built up enough strength to survive on the outside of the egg, because there's an equivalency to the amount of strength that they have to build to peck their way out is equivalent to the amount of energy that it require for them to survive on the outside of it.
Yep.
And so it's, you know, and the same with the chrysalis and the metaphor, if those wings aren't completely developed and you pry that thing open, it will die. So they can't do it for us. We have to save ourselves from ourselves. We have to outgrow our shell. And we have to outgrow our chrysalis, and we have to outgrow our own outdated, archaic mode of thinking. And we can free ourselves with thought. That's why your books, my books, and countless others, the things that, you know, the messages that we individually are putting out into the world, when people leap into it and read them, it liberates them. They're able to say, oh my God, I had an experience like that. And I never told anybody, you know, because I thought someone would think I was nuts. And so I just kept it to myself. And, you know, if Mike can write about this and if Andrea can write about that, then maybe it's okay for me to talk about it. Oh, gee, I'll think I'll go up to them at this event or that event and have a conversation. Have you ever noticed how somebody comes up to you and they might seem a little standoffish at first and a little reluctant to share, and then we warmly receive them, and then they gush out.
And then they gush because finally somebody's willing to listen. Yeah. And it's somebody, I get that so often that it'll be one of those, you know, I thought, you know, I thought people would think I was crazy, or I did tell somebody and they told me I was nuts, which is really unfortunate. And then they start telling the story and you're listening, you're like, yeah, that's similar to what I had here. And they're like, oh, really? Yeah. And then all of a sudden, boom, 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 the walls come down. And
yes.
Yeah. And it's fascinating. I'm really happy when I'm able to do that for people. That's one of my, you know, favorite parts of these events is being able to talk to people and connect and, you know, help people realize that, you know, they're not in this alone. You know, we're all here for each other. And I think that's, you know, a great thing about these events. And, you know, COVID, I mean, it hurt so much that we weren't able to get together. And I know some people have tried, you know, they tried the online events and, you know, there's still some of those going on where, you know, they're doing the online paracons and all that. But I think it's so important to actually get together and have the physical paracons, because you're able to, you know, really greet people and see people and share those stories. It, you know, people don't want to type all that stuff in a chat room or in a private message or whatever in one of those, you know, online affairs. You know, they want to be able to connect with somebody, look you in the eye and say, this is what happened to me.
Yeah. I don't know if you got to read Sharon's comment, but, you know, she's absolutely sharing your experiences, give many people the validation they were afraid to seek from others. And that's extremely well put. It's spot on. And you can't do that. Well, I suppose to a certain extent you can in a private chat on Facebook
or through an email.
It's
not the same.
But it's not. It's because when we're together, there is an energy exchange that cannot be duplicated any other way. And I've always said, you know, the strangest irony of COVID is that the people that you want to be closest to, the only way to let them know how much you love them is to stay the hell away from them.
I know.
You know,
it's bizarre. It's like
I know, absolutely.
She is freezing.
God,
she froze again.
Kidding. Yeah. Oh, God.
I can hear her
now,
voice.
I don't know. I don't know what
you were exuding that
Tony,
energy.
Tony, come in for a minute. Tony.
I'm in.
Tony, come back. Come back on EM. There he is. Okay. Tony, what's going on? Are we creating a disruption in the force? Is that what we're doing here?
Apparently so, because we went through everything. You're hardwired. Everything's connected. So, yeah, whatever interference is happening is a real mystery to me.
It is. It's spiritual. Well, stay with us. I know you have some questions for Mike, and it will give me a moment to lean over and to present the Princess Peanut Butter Cup. Hold on just a second. Oh, my God. Get over here. And let me present the Princess Peanut Butter.
There she is.
There she is.
Very cute.
I woke her up.
You know, one of the things, Mike, that you guys were talking about tonight, which, you know, just absolutely fascinating to me, the fact that, like Andrea said, that you go and you experience and investigate all these different types of places, but that you've connected them all on a universal level. And, you know, to me, that was great. I'm a little different where, you know, I'm going after, you know, the proof that they're speaking, that they're moving objects. Mm-hmm. But the fact that you can do that is fantastic. And I really like that comment you said about how, you know, it's universal and everything's connected. And that's such a great point, because it's true. And that doesn't matter whether it's from the paranormal to extraterrestrial to multidimensional. You're absolutely right. It's all interconnected. And that, I just thought that was just a great statement from you.
Well, thanks. It really is very connected. And yeah, I spoke at the Laughlin UFO Mega Conference earlier this year, just before the Egypt trip. And a lot of people, you know, my buddy Johnny Enoch got me into that. He was on the board there. And there were a couple others that were on the board that were like, "Well, why are you bringing in this guy? He's talking about paranormal stuff." And
I got the same thing at Star Wars. The same thing.
Yeah,
it's almost like UFO snobs. Well, isn't she the ghost lady? You know, what are you bringing her in here for?
Yeah, it's exactly.
Like, why don't you shut up and sit down and listen to what I talk about, and then tell me that this is irrelevant? Go ahead.
Exactly. And no, it's. Yeah, it was bizarre because my presentation was shadow people as extraterrestrials, because when you look at a number of the accounts and the stories people have told and sharing their experiences, it's almost like it depends on which lens you're viewing the experience through, because a lot of the same experiences that people talk about, okay, there was a shadow person, I woke up and it was in my room and I had sleep paralysis and all that. There are others that have basically the exact same experience, except to them, it was an ET rather than a shadow person. So the experience is the same if you just take the visage of whatever ET, apparition, shadow person, whatever, out of the picture. It's the same thing. So, and even because I've tried to get deeper into what happened with my own experiences. And so earlier this year, I had a hypnosis session for a couple of reasons. I had a past life regression, but one of the things was also to find out more information about my first shadow person experience when I was 8 years old, where I'd woken up, this thing was standing in my room. It physically interacted with me across my arms, across my body, and then it ran off. Of course, I was very frightened at that age when that happened. And, over the years, I thought it was a traumatic experience. Talking with others years later, they started suggesting, a couple different people suggested, well, maybe they thought you were dead and they were putting you in a burial pose. Kind of out of ancient Egypt, the crook and flail. It's like, okay, that's an interesting idea. So it got me thinking, at least, maybe it wasn't, some sort of evil entity or whatever. Maybe it was something else. And so during this hypnosis session, we went back to that moment. And I actually got to see the moment from the perspective of the shadow entity. So I'm basically like in the corner staring down at my 8-year-old self, all frightened and everything. And from the perspective of that entity, it actually was just there to watch and observe. It was learning more about humanity. It was learning about the human species. It wasn't there to do anything nasty or evil or whatever. And it didn't realize that I could see it. And once it realized that, it actually felt bad. And the whole crossing my arms was, there was a part in that hypnosis session that I saw differently than what I had recalled from my own memory. And that was when it crossed my arms like that, it patted me between the wrists too, like to say, I'm sorry, it'll be okay. So it was like trying to comfort me, give me a little hug sort of thing. And what's even more fascinating is, there's a question that the hypnotherapist threw out there about, okay, where are you from? And the response was, I'm from another space. And the follow-up question was, well, you mean like another dimension? And the response was, well, you might call it another dimension, but we're from another space, which I thought was really, really fascinating that this word space, again, you kind of draw the correlation to another dimension, but really it's some other ethereal plane or place in space-time that we just can't quite grasp. And I found that absolutely fascinating. So there's so much more to this than we really even can fathom.
Wow. Yeah, and what did you tell me when I asked you why you were interested in going to the Air Force? And you said, since I was a child, I was interested in space.
Exactly. That's
the word that you used.
It was. That's
true. In our vernacular, there are plenty of other words to use, and you chose space.
I chose space. That's true.
Great point. Great.
So another space, does that mean another universe? Maybe.
Maybe.
So it's something I'm going to keep diving into for sure.
Well, when I read your book about shadow people, before I even delved into it, I said to myself, walk in the shadows. I have a signed copy of that book
on
the bookshalf right behind me, by the way. So all the rest of you can just be jealous all you want, because I got pretty words written in there and all lovey stuff, and it's right there. But you know, I have to tell you, I thought that that was your first contact with extraterrestrials.
It probably was. It probably was. Yeah, I would agree with that at this point.
And
for years, I thought it was something else, but I think you're right.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And I also think that some of the things that happened to us at the farmhouse, there is a point of correlation and integration. And when you think about it, you know, between extraterrestrials and spirit, and when you think about it, and it doesn't, you know, what was it, Tony? What was it last week that John Tenney said about he doesn't think of it as interdimensional or extra-dimensional or multidimensional or ultra-dimensional? What was the word he used? Immer-dimensional? It all exists. Oh, and I'm going to have to go back and look at that.
Immersive dimensional or something along that immersive line.
Interesting.
Yeah.
That they were all connected and that you couldn't separate them. They were, they were just all there.
Yep. All.
Yeah. I mean, I believe that, you know, what we're searching for is right around us, you know,
all the time.
Yeah. All the time. You know, whether it's another point in time or, you know, some other universe or world, I think it's just overlapping with our current existence right now. Mm-hmm. You know, that if you could just, you know, lift the supposed veil or whatever, we would see all of this magnificent activity around us right now.
Well,
we would see entities, we'd see buildings, we'd see worlds, we'd see all kinds of different things.
Yeah, but that some of us can see interdimensionally, extra-dimensionally, however, you know, whatever words you choose in the vernacular, in the paranormal patois, you know, physical versus metaphysical. What if, as I have posited, that the veil is a human machination? It's a way that we protect ourselves and literally conform into our shell in our little three-dimensional world. So, because it feels safe and warm and cozy, but you know, what if there is no veil? What if that is a construct of our own way of thinking so that we can function in this world while we are here in a more comfortable way? Because if I can see what I've seen and my whole family can see what we've seen, doesn't that mean that everybody could, given the right dynamics, the right environment, the right situation, doesn't that mean that literally anyone and everyone can have that? And maybe that the world awakening is that process of prying wide open the third eye en masse so that all of us can have these experiences? Because I cannot tell you if I can delineate between the apparitions that I saw at the farmhouse and definitively say, yeah, that was a ghost, or yeah, that was an extraterrestrial. And wouldn't it also stand to reason that if ghosts or spirits are no longer in this world in a physical vessel, that automatically qualifies them as extraterrestrials?
Yeah, I think so, because if they're on another plane of existence, that puts them in a whole other world. So for us to witness them, yeah, we'd be witnessing an extraterrestrial. But you know, I like you using the word construct. You know, is this world that's around us something that we've constructed? Because we're in a temporary shell in this body. Is this a world that we've constructed to be able to experience or learn or what have you, and to keep the rest of everything else out, so that, kind of like you said, we're in our own comfy little bubble here to experience these things. But you know, with everything being energy and frequency and wavelength, sometimes, you know, those frequencies from one dimension to another resonate at the same level, and we get a little glimpse of that. And some people are able to do that better than others. But I think, you know, especially, you know, us, I think we've seen a little bit more, and you know, that's where we see the ghosts or the apparitions, or you have your time slips, or, you know, what have you.
That's a great point, Mike, because the human body, I mean, if you take any of the senses, sight, you know, we see a fragment of the actual, mm-hmm. of the actual light zone. I mean, I think
it's a limited, like limited amount of the spectrum that we see. Yeah.
Right. And, you know, our hearing drops off at 20 Hertz and 20 megahertz. There's all sorts of sound that, and so, yeah, to me, the human body is a restricting factor to keep us focused on the here and now, the 3D world. And, but some people have the ability to break beyond that. And that's, you know, those are the people you want to listen to and hear what they have to say if you can't do it yourself. But, yeah, I definitely think that we are restricted just because how overwhelming would it be to see everything else? And then to me, that would be a huge distraction from maybe what I'm supposed to learn here and now.
I want the distraction.
Yeah, I know. I think that that's my my greatest gift is my ability to show others how to see what I see, mm-hmm. To introduce them to the galactic family. And, you know, Mike, I only started doing that about 6 or 7 years ago. And it happened spontaneously. Somebody said, you know, are you going outside? And I said, yeah, I'm just going to go say good night to the galactic family. And they said, can I come? That's when it began. And I just sing a little song to them and thank them for coming and being here. It's completely natural to me. It's not paranormal. It's normal. And then before I knew it, I had little crowds forming around me. Oh, she's going outside. Let's go see what she's going to go do. Mm-hmm. And then before I knew it, I was introducing people to them in broad daylight, in the middle of the night. Doesn't matter. You know, they make themselves known to those who are receptive, who are ready, who are willing, because I believe that we are all able. We are all able to make that contact, to make that connection. It's whether or not you're willing to. And it's not even just necessarily about opening the third eye. I have discovered that I can see and others can see them literally with our eyes closed. Literally with our eyes closed. Just look up into the dark of the sky at night and close your eyes. And you will start to see pings and flashes and arcs of light. And,
oh, yeah.
You know, and you don't even need that sense that you've relied so heavily upon to validate everything that you've experienced in your lifetime. That's our primary sense, is sight, at, you know, and rivaled only by our sense of hearing, sound. Well, if everything is frequency and everything is visual, and these are the things that are the stimuli, the main stimuli, and we can literally not rely upon them to interact with the universe. How incredible is that, to discover that our sensory receptors go far beyond the 5 given senses that we're born with in a 3D dimension, that's just the tip of Machu Picchu.
Right there behind Tony. You know, I think we need to learn to let go, you know, let go of what we've been accustomed to and be open. Yeah. And, you know, that's when we really start to connect. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah.
So Mike, I have a question for you, and don't quote me on where I read this, but
okay.
When you were over in Egypt, this story came out probably 2 years ago, but it was about this little boy that was explaining, had this immense knowledge of space and just other planets. But he said something about the Great Pyramids and the Sphinx. And he said that there was something behind the Sphinx ear And once we as humans learned either to operate it or turn it on, it would change the world. Do you know what article I'm talking about? Does that ring any bells?
It sounds vaguely familiar, but I couldn't give you the specifics of it. Yeah, there's a lot of mysterious things there about the Sphinx. You know, you look back into articles from like the late 1800s, you know, newspaper articles, and you know, they talk about, you know, the explorers at the time had found passages within the Sphinx. You know, there used to be a hole at the top of the Sphinx, and from there, they said that you could actually climb down into it, and there are these chambers within it, and then underneath the Sphinx, you know, it's supposed to be a temple and the Hall of Records and all that. Edgar Casey had the prediction that we would eventually find, you know, that chasm there under the paw. And sure enough, you know, Schock and West, when they were doing their research and did some seismic testing, there was a chasm there, right, where Edgar Casey said. The interesting thing is that a lot of that has been, you know, covered up. They filled in the hole. You don't hear people talk about, you know, the hole in the head of the Sphinx and being able to climb down in there. Now, the thing with the chamber under the paw, that still gets talked about, but some of these other things don't, and you kind of wonder, okay, you know, if this was a big thing 100 years ago, and you don't see like any refuting evidence against it that said, well, we debunked all that or whatever, it's just kind of like we're not talking about it anymore,
right?
You know, so there's things that they're hiding, you know, and even with the the chamber under the paw, you know, Egyptian antiquities authorities tried to come forward and say, well, there's really nothing down there. And then yet you see photos of Zahi Hawass coming up out of this hole out of the ground right next to the Sphinx. And it's like, what's he doing down there? What's he checking out? So there's something going on.
Well, that's the perfect explanation, because I remember reading that. That was, like I said, 2 or 3 years ago. And never heard, you know, about anybody looking into it, anybody doing anything with it. It just disappeared.
It's really restricted these days. It was kind of, you know, years ago, it was kind of a free-for-all. You could go out there and run these, you know, different tests and experiments. But these days, like when I went into the Great Pyramid, they would not let me record certain experiments that I wanted to try in there. So they told me, okay, you know, you can use your different meters here. We do not want you recording it at all, because we don't want, you know, your different tests and everything getting out on the internet and all of that, because they're really trying to restrict the information that comes out of there, you know, which is very unfortunate. They have a certain narrative that they want to tell, and if you're running an experiment in there and it flies in the face of their current narrative, that's bad news for them. They don't want that.
It really is. I have a question from our dear friend Skywatcher. There been any new updates on the Hawass complex that Dr. Carmen Bolter was waiting on Egyptian government for excavation permits in that area? Supposedly new labyrinths and chambers.
Yeah, not that I know of. I mean, at least not that I've seen. And that's, again, you know, people will, you know, either, you know, they believe something's there, or they actually have, even if they have some evidence that says there are chambers under here, or there are, you know, passageways or whatever. Yeah, it's going to be a while before they get permission. Even if it's already like well known and documented. If just for an example, we were at the Temple of Dendera this year. And, you know, the one, it's the temple that has the one crypt there where it has the Dendera light bulb and all that, which it's not really a crypt as we see it. There were never any bodies there. It's just a chamber that's under the temple. Well, there's another crypt that's there as well, and they just opened it up this year. They claim that we were the first ones, you know, tour group to get in there and take a look. I don't know if that's true, but that's what they told us. What's interesting, though, this crypt had been closed off for 20 years. It previously been opened, closed off for 20 years, open it back up, and you're down there, and you're like, okay, this is cool. You're seeing the different inscriptions and friezes and all that stuff. And then, you know, you're looking, and you're like, there are big chunks missing here out of the wall. And you come to realize, and you're looking at it, it's like, But this stuff didn't like just fall out over time. I'm not seeing pieces of it on the floor. In fact, in the wall where that
it was excavated already. Bin,
yeah, you're seeing these chisel marks, and they're rather fresh. You know, they're white chisel marks. These are not chisel marks from like 2,000 years ago or whatever, or even 100 years ago. These are pretty fresh, and it's like that's what they've been doing over the past 20 years. They went down there and they took out chunks that told a different narrative that they didn't want getting out, and just kind of off on the side, I'm talking to people. I'm like, and I'm expressing my, you know, what I've noticed, and they kind of reluctantly said, yeah, you know, you have private collectors that wanted certain pieces that had esoteric knowledge. You know, people are looking for the keys and the secrets to everlasting life, and those private collectors get into bidding wars.
It's, you know, so and it's hearing stories like that that make me feel hopeless about humanity.
Yeah.
It really does. It's like a kick in the gut to do that kind of damage because of a bidding war between the uber wealthy of who's going to have what part of something that belongs to the whole world.
Belongs to the whole world, and they want some inscription that they believe is gonna, you know, make them live forever or what have you.
Yeah.
To answer Tony's question, yeah, he might not see a permit to get down there for 10 or 20 years because somebody else is gonna go through there first and take out what they want, and then they'll say, oh yeah, you can get in here now after all the important stuff is gone.
That so makes me sick to my stomach.
I know it. Yeah. It literally makes me sick to my stomach.
Yeah.
I know it's and it makes me feel hopeless for humanity. It yeah. makes me feel like, you know, how much progress are we going to make globally? You know, in terms of a realization of oneness in the human race, when a handful of people control all the money, a handful of people control all the currency, a handful of people control all the property, and a handful of people exploit anything and everything and anyone and everyone for their own fun and profit. So there's where the real paradigm shift needs to occur. That's absolutely where it needs to occur. It yeah, needs I to be a agree. Crisis of conscience. And I mean, the microcosm of that exists right in our own paranormal community, because, you know, when people come across this, you know, amazing evidence, they hoard it, they hold it back, they, you know, claim it as their own. This is mine. No, this is mine. In Egypt, you know, this is ours. No, this is ours. Okay, you know what? You know what Edgar Mitchell said when he was out in space? He looked back at this fragile blue orb, and allow me to paraphrase,
sure,
that he wants to grab a politician by the ear and drag them all the way out there and then turn them around and say, look at that, you son of a bitch. You know, yeah, and I so admire Edgar Mitchell for just, I had the opportunity to meet him before he passed away. And
oh, fantastic.
He was, and Buzz Aldrin too. I had a really long talk with Buzz Aldrin. It was illuminating, to say the least.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Yeah. It's we'll have a whole nother show about that one night. I'm telling
there
you.
There you go.
Okay. I'm being told that we have 5 minutes left. And in that 5 minutes, Mr. Okay. Ricksecker, why don't you tell everybody how they can reach out to you, be in touch with you? I know they all love you as much as I do. So, you know, we can just how to find you, where to find you.
Yeah, so MikeRicksecker.com is my personal website. You know, all my books are listed out there. Of course, Amazon, Barnes & Noble, all those wonderful sites. Well, you know, these are the two latest, A Walk in the Shadows and Alaska's Mysterious Triangle, but I have 12 books now to date, so you can find all that stuff out there. Also, check out the Shadow Dimension docuseries that's running free on Tubi right now. So you can go to Tubi TV. You can go to shadowdimension.com as well and check out all the information out there, the different trailers and features. And it has the links there to where you can watch the docuseries. And then there is my rather new online learning platform called the Connected Universe Portal. So connectedUniversePortal.com. I have all kinds. I have courses out there. I have all kinds of articles. We have the Connecting the Universe interactive class out there. There's behind the scenes videos, sneak peek videos. I just did a whole American Southwest thing because I was out there for those couple of conferences. So there's like Sedona, Montezuma as well, White Sands, all this stuff. And then there's a whole it's like 10 and a half hours worth of video footage and a travel blog and all this information on Egypt from this past year as well. So connectinguniverseportal.com.
Well, it has been our pleasure. I know that I can speak for Tony as well. Absolutely our pleasure to welcome you on the show tonight. We see each other pretty frequently, have each other on speed dial on our phones. You know, it's you enrich my life enormously.
And as you do for me as well.
I feel like I have a sounding board, a star brother, somebody who totally gets me. And that's a rarity, especially when you're as weird as I am. I am so deeply
weird is good. Weird is the new normal.
Yeah, well, me honors the weirdness in you. And so that's it right. is. As we wind down tonight, I always leave our audience with a message, and I allow that message to come through to me as I prepare to say goodnight. And the message that I'm receiving tonight is we know nothing compared with what there is to know, and the motivating factor of our spiritual selves is to keep seeking ourselves, that there is a wealth of knowledge within each and every one of us. And once we begin to tap into our internal light, it will illuminate our world and the universe beyond. So that is the message that I will leave everyone with tonight. And I love you dearly. I love you dearly.
I love you too, my friend.
You have a wonderful night. Thank you so, so much for joining us. And bless you,
sweetheart. Well, thank you. And welcome to the KGRA family.
Thank you. I feel so comfy and cozy here. Almost as good as wearing my unicorn slippers.
Oh, there you go. There you go. Now, I love you, Annie. And thank you so much for having me on the show tonight.
And thank you to our wonderful viewers and our listeners at KGRA and beyond. I'm very happy here, very comfortable here. I'm among family, and yet we are one big, extraordinary family. And once we tap into that understanding of our oneness, we will all begin to heal the world together. Good night, everyone. See you next week from the farm.